evening. First of all, I would like to thank Ms. Jen Park for your kindly introduction. I am simply overwhelmed with honor. So on behalf of the Holy Martyrs of Vietnam Catholic Church, I would like to extend our warmest welcome to Assistant State Attorney Stefan Ritter and all of our distinguished guests to our church tonight. So we are both grateful and humbled to co-host the Open Record Forum tonight. As a community of faith, we are instructed not only to be good, honorable Christians, but also responsible citizens. And as citizens, we all have a shared responsibilities to work hand in hand with the elected officials to conduct government affairs in a manner that benefits the people. So the former Attorney General Thurber Baker said it best when he stated, "I strongly believe that government operates best when it operates openly." So I applaud and thank you for your efforts such as promoting Georgia sunshine laws and educating to the public and to bring about more transparency in our government. So once again, welcome you all and may God bless you all.
So here's how the evening's going to run. We're going to have Mr. Ritter come up in a few moments and start his presentation. And we'd encourage each of you to ask questions during the presentation. That's fine. He said that that is appropriate. Try to keep them content specific. So we really are laser focused on learning the details of the law that he's presenting to us tonight. After he's done with his presentation, if you ask questions, we're going to take a 10-minute break, grab some food, and then we're going to have people, if you'd like to stand up and share your experience, and then just kind of get some feedback back and forth with Mr. Ritter, then that's what will happen about the last 30 minutes. If you have to go to the restroom before the break or whatever, just the restrooms are straight back and to your left, and you'll see them if you just keep walking a little bit. Oh, there's more over here. Okay, there's bathrooms all over the place. So there's some over here too. So just go either way, whichever is more comfortable for you. Okay, so without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Mr. Stefan Ritter. And I'm going to read his bio. Stefan Ritter is a senior assistant attorney general in the attorney general's office and has been practicing law for 25 years. He is the supervisor of the attorney general's education, elections, governmental services, and judiciary section. This section, among other things, is responsible for general open government advice and policy, prepared the initial draft of the new open government law, and has an informal mediation program in which it attempts to resolve open government disputes between citizens and local governments. Through this program, Mr. Ritter's section saw in excess of 400 open government issues last year alone. Mr. Ritter and his section frequently litigate numerous other issues around the state and frequently handle high-profile education and election cases. We are so fortunate to have Mr. Ritter here. Please take advantage of the next 2 hours, listen, learn, and we're going to be a better Gwinnett because of it. So thank you very much.
Folks, can you hear me okay? I'm sort of a wanderer while I speak, so excuse me if I come back and forth. Again, let me reiterate what Ms. Fox said. Please, if you have questions while I'm talking, don't wait to ask your questions. I delight in trying to answer the questions right at this time. Like you often hear, if you've got a question about something, someone else probably has the same issue as well. And I've heard a lot of these issues. I've got to tell you, we'll talk about our mediation program in a moment, but we receive dozens of calls every week. I usually get 4 to 6 to 10 calls every day, or emails, or letters, or faxes. It's incredible the amount of response that we get in our office, people who are concerned about open government issues. And we're really interested in trying to address those so that both citizens and government officials know what the law is so they can work together to make our government transparent. Anyway, I always want to begin by telling folks that I'm from the government, so I'm here to help you. And what I do, as Jen said, is I actually supervise a section which is called the Elections, Education, Governmental Services, and Judiciary section, which is a big mouthful. You'll notice nowhere in that list does it say open government. We do a lot of election law. We do a lot of education law. As a matter of fact, I thought I'd be late tonight because of ongoing issues with the DeKalb County School Board, who filed a lawsuit against a couple of my clients, the governor and the school board today. Somewhere in there, during the period when Thurber Baker was the Attorney General of the state of Georgia, we decided to create voluntarily a new program to try to address concerns that we were getting from citizens about open government issues. Often the case, the citizens really don't feel like they have a place they can go with these, and they would have to go to court, file a lawsuit if their governments were not being responsive. The current Attorney General, Sam Mullins, came into office 2 years some ago, and he said that his priority was to make transparency in government work. So he picked up right where Thurber and left off. And they're both, I work for both of them. I was actually hired by Mike Bowers. They both have taken this as a very serious concern. And I will tell you, in the January, right after he was sworn in, Sam said, we need to change Georgia's open government law so that it is clear. Because if you used to read the old open government law, you just pick it up and start reading the statute, you would have no idea what was really required. And that's before the courts got a hold of it. Court interpretations of the open government laws, which are open meetings and open records, were so far afield that you would not know what was required, what you could get, what you could do in a meeting, what documents you were entitled to see, or government officials, what your responsibilities were. So there was some effort to clarify the law. We only did the first draft. General Assembly took it from there. They put their own special magic into it. And I do, to be fair, think that they did some stuff that was good. They made some good changes. We think some stuff didn't get through that should have. Some stuff came out that should have stayed in. But they you know, that's what their role is. And they did, I think, at the end of the day, met a compromise. During the process of working on this law, we met with numerous citizens. We met with county commissioners. We met with local government, city folks. But we also met with the press and press agencies and had multiple meetings trying to work this out, as well as meeting with legislators. End of the day, Sam ran a very open shop try to come to the new legislation. And I think we came out with a pretty good product. Bottom line, though, on this product is not to try to change, by and large, there's a few changes, not to try to change the requirements of the law, but to try to make them clear. Those changes, by the way, became effective April 17th of last year. They're the law now. Anything that goes on now, when you make a request, when you go have a meeting, the new law applies. Okay, the Attorney General does not have very much authority in Georgia law over the function of local government. In fact, that's true in most states in the United States, but it's certainly true in Georgia. I hear, in addition to open government issues, about alleged violations from cities and counties every day from citizens. Sometimes outrageous alleged violations of government laws, which our office can do nothing about because we have no authority in that area. Our authority, however, was carved out through Thurber Baker and continued through Sam Olens to have something to do with open government. So we can't pursue those. Our authority is either civil or criminal. The criminal, however, is a misdemeanor. So we are not going to pursue the criminal aspects because they're so slight in terms of the sanctions we can get, and the burden is so great in trying to do it, unless we really have to. We generally are going to proceed civilly if we have to go to court. But an important change was that we can now go to court and get sanctions in a civil case. It was not the law before. Now we can go to court in a civil case, $1,000 for the first violation, $2,500 for each additional violation within a 12-month period. This is much more than it used to be. This actually gives the law some teeth, so we can do something about it. Let me emphasize, as I spoke about our program, our role in the AG's office is not to try to sanction if we can avoid it. We don't either have the time or the resources, after all, this is a voluntary program that we sort of created out of whole cloth, to go out and try to sanction everybody who might violate the law. If we go to court, we represent the state. We do not represent the citizen or the organization that had its rights violated. Citizens want to go to court, they have the right to go to court. Citizens have the right to file their own lawsuits and seek their own relief for things that allegedly happened that were wrong. Our goal in the mediation program is instead to get citizens and governments to work together. And when we hear about a government that may have violated the open government laws, our contact is first going to be to that government to say, did you really do this? This is what they're saying. Here's what they claim, and if you did, can you fix it? We assume that these violations are usually in good faith, and they usually are. These are officials who don't know what their responsibilities are, because the law is complex, they made a mistake, we talked to their attorney, and lo and behold, pronto, it's fixed. I'll give you an example. Right now, I received a complaint about 3 or 4 days ago, end of last week, about someone who had sent a series of open records requests seeking jail logs from sheriffs. Many sheriffs. Most were very responsive. Few were not responsive. We contacted the ones who were not responsive of their counsel. Every single one of them, through their counsel, immediately said, oops, and fixed it, or is in the process of fixing it. So these officials, and you get a lot of officials, generally want to do the right thing. There are exceptions. And we've got a case going on right now with one set of officials who think knew they were doing wrong and wouldn't fix it. And we expect that we're going to have other cases that will be doing the same thing. Okay, so there are two parts to Georgia's open government law. Open meetings, open records. It's not on the slide. But here's a general idea I would like everybody to understand as we talk about these laws. These laws are about citizens being able to see what their governments and their governmental officials are doing. That's the important thing to understand, is to see what the officials are doing. These laws, as much as it's a good idea, are not about citizen participation. Citizen participation is great. We encourage that. We like that. But that's not what the Open Meetings or the Open Records Act does. They say you can go to a meeting and observe it, videotape it, photograph it, audio record it. They do not say that you have a right to participate in the meeting. We like it when questions are asked. I like it. We think that officials should allow that, but the law does not require it at the state level. same thing for records. He does not require officials answer questions. This is so important to understand. Our law is not about, hey, Mr. Official, could you tell me what your position is on something? Our law is about, do you have a record on this? That's what it calls for. So when you make an Open Records Act request, you're asking about what records exist at this time that are responsive to this. And as we get to records, I will tell you how to make a good Open Records Act request. But those requests are for records that are in existence, not to create new records. Okay, open meetings. One of the important changes to the open meetings law, I'm gonna stop for a moment, rest, I wanna say something. Not only ask your questions, but keep in mind, I'm gonna go through this very fast. You gotta slow me down if I'm going too fast for you, please. Okay, open meetings. One of the big changes was that we changed the definition of meetings so it's coherent. Used to be, if you'd open up the law, the statute book, and you look at the definition of meeting, it made no sense. It contradicted itself. It had so many subordinate clauses, you could not understand really what a meeting is. The General Assembly clarified that. I said we, the General Assembly, they clarified it. It's now the law that if a quorum of an agency talks about their business, it's a meeting. Period. Quorum, talking about the business of that agency, that's a meeting. So what's an agency? Agency is any governmental body that has officials that are required to gather together and talk about stuff. State, local, authorities, cities, committees of those. If they're a formally appointed committee, if a committee has been formally created, we treat it just like any other agency. So the city can't say, I'm going to create a committee, and then they don't have to have meetings and we can do it privately. Sir?
What constitutes formal?
Formal means, and the law's not clear about this, but in our view, formal means that there's been some sort of express statement, usually in writing, but maybe at a meeting, saying we are going to appoint a committee to handle this. Or we'll have the mayor appoint a committee. Or the mayor sends out an email and says, I want the following people to be on a committee. Somehow, consistent with the law, that committee would have been appointed. Now, I will tell you, there are folks out there who feel that it is broader than that formal appointment. That's fair. They're entitled to their viewpoint on that. That is not a viewpoint that our office at the moment has adopted. They may litigate that, that's their right. But our view in our office right now is formal committee. You can't stretch it beyond that because it's too vague as to what that is. By the way, those committees, if they are formally appointed, can include citizens as well as board members. There's a case on that. It involves the, during the Olympics, there was a committee for housing as part of the Olympics. Formally created committee, had citizens on this committee, it was subject to the open meetings law at that time. Again, our view, formally created committee. Okay, so they discussed business, they got a quorum, that's enough. Got five members, three people get together, that's a quorum, that's business, they have to do it. Ma'am.
We have a microphone.
Hold on,
please.
Sorry.
Just yelled, sorry. I know this was discussed when it was going through the committee process. What about travel? So if you have three or four members of a committee who are all traveling together, gotcha, thank you, sorry.
Right, got it. Okay, so it was very important to clarify what some of the things are that are not meetings. Because before, this really was very vague, and people would do things that we thought were meetings and they thought were not meetings. Now the law provides these five exceptions. These are my summaries of them. That's not the little words of the statute. But if you go out as a government, you inspect physical facilities, not a meeting. You have a statewide meeting where you come together for training. Not a meeting. You gather together with another agency. generally not to conduct specific business of your agency, but simply to gather and discuss your relationship with them, not a meeting. Travel, if it's just for travel, not a meeting. You have a holiday party, not a meeting. I had a client who was very concerned because they had a holiday party a year ago, or a year and a half ago, and I had to tell them, you know, the law's sort of iffy about that. Don't conduct business. Now it's clear, not a meeting, as long as no official business is conducted at that time. Now the law isn't clear about how far that official business exception goes. But I will tell you that if you say have a city council of five people, and three people get in a car to travel someplace, we would expect them not to talk shop during that trip.
Excuse me, we have a question down here.
Yes, yes, sir.
In the case of a group of elected officials and other agencies who have perhaps gone out of state to conduct a meeting, when they are discussing county business and discussing the reorganization of the development initiative in the county, would that be considered a meeting?
That's very fact specific, and I'm not going to answer that as I stand here right now. I'll tell you this. I'm not trying to dodge the question, but tell you that we need to know more facts about what actually happened, what they understood to be, what they were doing, how specific the proposals were, whether they voted on something, and so forth. We can discuss all of that, but I will tell you, certainly if they had a vote, that would be illegal. And if we had reason to believe that they were intentionally trying to avoid having the meeting and was this just a ruse, that would certainly be an important issue for us. But I'm not going to tell you an answer right here as I stand here, because that's, at this point in time, too close to the line. It's a gray area, quite frankly. Ma'am.
So if a board of elected officials have a retreat for the purpose of discussing the business of whatever the board is that they're representing, is that considered a meeting?
Absolutely. If they're not meeting with another agency, if they're having their own retreat, and that retreat is not for training, so a training meeting would be okay, but if it's not for training, it's actually to conduct their business, but they're doing it at a retreat, still a meeting. It's still a meeting, because they gather together, they add a quorum, and they discuss business, that's a meeting. That's all you have to have. Sir?
I serve on the Board of Trustees of Charter Schools, and the charter movement is common that boards have retreats. The strategy, the future, not conduct business per se, but to do team building, that sort of thing. That's still under the open.
I think it is. And I would tell you that there are folks who might disagree with that. Our view in this office right now is that if they're getting together as a quorum discussing business, retreat or not a retreat, that's a meeting. Okay. I understand people want to get together and have these general planning things, but when you are in the government sphere, you have an obligation to let the public in the door to hear what you're going to do. Again, not to participate, but to hear what's going on. That is an obligation. Okay, so what does the Open Meetings Act require? Well, of course, the first thing it requires is that you have to have them be open. That means the public and the press get to attend. As I said, not necessarily to participate. Great if they allow questions, but that's not what state law requires. And they're entitled to record the meeting. Law is very clear about this. You're entitled to video record, audio record a meeting. Take photographs during the meeting. We've got a case, as I mentioned before, going on where City of Cumming did not allow that. They disagree about the outcome, so the case is in litigation, but I will tell you that this was a case where they asked a young woman who was recording the meeting to stop recording the meeting, and unfortunately, she recorded them saying, you're not allowed to record the meeting. So, I think we have a good case. They think they maybe have a good case. This is not their side of the story, but, you know, the law is plain that you're allowed to video record meetings. Okay. Votes that are taken in violation
question.
So once you record it, what are you allowed to do with it?
That's your recording. You can do whatever you want with it.
Can share that in any kind of a public forum with your own?
Post it on the internet. Put it on YouTube. You can send an email with it. Wrap it up and give it to your kids for Christmas. Very strange kids. Ma'am.
Are there any exceptions to official meetings that are not open to the public? You know, something that might be classified or whatever?
Absolutely. And we're going to get to that in just a minute. Sit tight. We're almost there. Okay. So, votes. In the view of our office, no vote is binding if it should have been taken in a meeting, if it was taken in private rather than in public. As we'll discuss when we get to the exceptions, there are a couple instances where you can take a pre-vote, but it's not binding. Only the open vote is binding, and every vote must be open. There's a rule on challenging these votes, however. If you want to say the vote is illegal, wasn't taken in the open, you have 90 days to file that lawsuit and a 6-month period to find out about it. So if the vote was in secret and 10 months go by, even though no one knew that a secret vote was taken, that's too late.
I have a question back here.
Yes, sir.
You previously talked about meetings and giving notice, and it's a little previous to what you are discussing, but how much notice needs to be given when meetings are held?
Good question. Meetings are held. It takes us to our next slide. Notice and agenda. Oh, hold on, we've got another question, ma'am.
Can you hold, please? If you have questions, please just raise your hand and we'll bring the microphone to you. We want to share with everyone, please. Thank you.
Okay, the court action. Why do you want to file a complaint really not wanting to take a personal court action when you're aware of an open meeting violation?
Well, if you find out about an open meetings violation, or an open records violation for that matter, you can contact our office. We like to get contact on paper. So send me an email. In fact, rather than waiting to the end, let me tell everybody my email address right now. Give you my phone number as well. And again, trust me, I get a lot of contacts, so if I miss you, you just take that as par for the course and keep trying. Because I do get a lot of messages and a lot of contacts. My email address is sritter, sritter, @law.ga.gov. sritter@law.ga.gov. My phone number is 404-656-7298. 404-656-7298. That's the closest I have, by the way, to a direct dial. They still catch my calls, but I invite you, if you really have something that you cannot work out, and I always want you to try to work it out first, you can call us. If you want to make a complaint with our office, I want at least an email and probably a letter or a fax. I get a lot, and we can't address every single one. Now, here's the thing about this. That is not the same as going to court. Because if we say we think they violated the law, we are dependent on the good graces of those government officials to say, okay, we will comply with the law. If we find recurrent violators who ignore our advice, we'll take them to court. If we find serious violations that we think are unremedied, we'll take them to court. Again, we represent the state, not you, when we do that. But we do not have the resources to take every single one to court. So you want to go to court, you want an order saying you must do this, you need to go to court. And the best way to go to court is to hire an attorney. It's expensive, it's a pain. That's why we created our mediation program. Our mediation program exists to try to amicably resolve these things. Because again, government officials, most of the time, I think are really trying to act in good faith, even when they stumble.
And they're happy when we tell them, no, you got it wrong. You need to do it this way. They'll often do it. We've got two questions. Let me start. First over here.
So how would an indigent person address violations if they have a violation, they come to your office, they're not able to hire?
Right, and I appreciate that. The question is, how does an indigent person who can't afford to hire an attorney? Attorneys are expensive for everybody to hire. And sometimes it seems like the cost for an attorney outweighs what you're gonna get. The bottom line is, we do not function as legal aid. You can go to legal aid and try to get it, or you can go into court pro se. You can get a group of like-minded citizens to go and share the cost, but we cannot represent you. We do not have the authority to represent citizens going into court.
For your mediation program, how does that interact with this 30-day deadline? Pause.
The mediation program that we have is nowhere stated in statute. In other words, we created it as a way to try to resolve disputes. But this 90-day period that I mentioned a moment ago, and it's down on the bottom of this, that is not told because it came to us. So if you have an open meetings violation and you need to get into court right away to remedy that vote, you need to go to court. Do not wait for us. I hate it when citizens say, I talked to you and I didn't go to court. You have an obligation to go to court, take care of it. You want to do that. We have the discretion to decide whether we want to take something to court or not. I've got another question right here.
So you said that if agencies or boards are not following your advice, that you're giving them, that they're violating the Open Meetings or Records Act. And you said after several times of that, how many examples?
I can't answer that question because it depends on the severity of the violations and whether we think there's an intentional practice of ignoring what we've requested. And whether they refuse to work it out, and just a host of things would affect whether we decide to go to court. I can't make any promises about any specific cases. Let me do add one thing though, because I do hear about this occasionally, and you know, our time is limited, so I'm going to try to move through this quickly, but do keep in mind, our office represents the state. So we cannot mediate against the state. How does it work then when you have a state agency that you think is violating the law? Contact us. We won't mediate that, but we're going to give them the same advice we would give local governments. Where at the end of the day, we can't be responsible for how they act, but we can tell you that we'll give them the same advice we give local governments. We don't play favorites, and we expect state agencies, unlike local governments, to treat what we tell them they are required by law to do as the word. That is what the requirements are. So we expect state agencies, executive branch agencies, to follow the law. And we tell them what that is. Okay, let me move forward.
Have a question.
Yes, quick. Isn't that a conflict of interest, though, since the Attorney General's office represents all the state agencies?
Well, that's just the point. We do not mediate with state agencies because we would have a conflict in that.
Right.
So we don't mediate those, as I said. What we do is we still give them advice. I'm telling you the advice we give state agencies is exactly the same as we would tell a local government as to what we think the law is.
All right, but the individuals that are representing those agencies are still from the Attorney General's office.
Correct.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering why it seems to be so slanted a short term for statute of limitations for something potentially criminal by our government officials with this.
Because that's the way the General Assembly created it. I can say that, you know, I think there were times that we would have been much happier if they had more time in there. That comes from the General Assembly.
Did the Attorney General, were they consulted about this?
We did not recommend that period. But that period, this 90-day period, that's been in the law for a very long time. I would say in excess of 10 years.
It's very convenient for the people that hold office.
Well,
for it to be such a short term.
I can say that's what the law is, and that's what it is. And did our office say we should do it very short? No, we did not.
And you didn't challenge it either.
That's not accurate. We have another question for you.
Oh, I have one back.
I know your office has a mediation process. However, is there any type of fail-safe for local government when they are ignoring advice from your mediation office? Is there any other ramifications or avenues that we can take local government who are so arrogant that they don't even feel that they have to answer citizens back and ignore them?
You have three options. Three options if local governments ignore what we said. Number one, take it to court yourself. And you have a court, exhibit one, we went to the Attorney General's office, and they said it's a violation of the law. That's number one. Number two, if it's criminal, you can establish the standard, which standard of care, that is they acted willfully in doing this. You can take it to the district attorney or solicitor and say this is a violation, it's a criminal act, and see if they're interested in prosecuting that. I can tell you they're usually not. Number three is political. You can say, A, we're going to oppose you for re-election because you violate the law. We're going to make it a campaign issue. And in extreme cases, if you can establish it, violations of these laws, if they can be established, are a basis for recall petitions. However, again, that's very difficult. A lot of signatures required. But you do have remedies. The main remedy that the law requires or relies on is you taking it to court. That's the bottom line. Okay, was there another question?
Yes, hi, Mr. Ritter, how are you today? I just need clarification. This gentleman stated that if there's a violation, the violation is then reported to your office, right?
Yes.
Okay, and you pretty much are representing the state or a government agency. I guess my question is, and then I piggyback on this lady back here who made a statement as well,
right,
which did add some clarification to the political gyration that goes on and lack of execution thereof. Mm-hmm. But what I'm not understanding very clearly is if, let's say I came to you and I said, you know, I believe that there's a violation being taking place.
Yes.
What support do you give the person that came to you? Because what I'm hearing is the support is being focused on providing information back to the government agency, but the person that came to you that's asking for help, do they actually get some advice from you and support?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
But let's clarify that, because that's a good question, and I don't want anybody to be uncertain about this. Okay, number one, we're not there as the representative of local governments. We'll tell them what the law is. We cannot appear on citizens' behalf, which is why we call it the mediation program. We appear in the middle and try to resolve the dispute. We're certainly going to tell citizens what we think the law is. In fact, almost all of our questions come from citizens, not governments. And most of the time, we're talking to citizens about what we think the law is. And when we contact a local government about the law, they think that we're acting on behalf of the citizen. And in fact, we will act on behalf of the citizen if we think that they're being violent. We just can't go to court on the citizen's behalf.
Totally understand.
Okay? And frankly, what you need to understand about this, representing the state or citizens, so important to understand, this is a voluntary program. It's not called for by statute. There's no mandatory obligation to do this. We're actually acting as volunteers. We really want to help. And our action as volunteers means that we can't provide everything that people want. You want us to go against the state? We'll give the state clients the same advice and information that we would local governments. But we cannot go against them. But what's our choice? Not have a program at all? Right. We are going to do what we can. Try to get, this is an informal process to really, you know, avoid the bureaucracy, avoid the courts. Let's try to get good answers, get things resolved.
Georgia citizens calls for accountability. Thanks you.
Thank you. Okay, well, I'm going to move forward fairly fast now because we are running out of time. Okay, here's the bottom line. You go to a meeting, you are entitled as a citizen, and you are required if you're an official to provide notice of the meeting. A week in advance if it's a regular meeting. A regular meeting is the one that you say, like, our city meets every second Tuesday in the month. That's a regular meeting. They can have special meetings as well. Special meetings have their own notice requirements. I can tell you, they can even have meetings if they have to have a meeting,
and meet the requirements for less than 24 hours, but they're going to have to meet those requirements, provide the notice on the door, provide it to the legal organ. They are not required to take a list of citizens who'd like special notice and mail it to certain people, by the way. Agenda. The agenda rule amazingly says agendas are not required more than 2 weeks in advance. That's not really very helpful, because it doesn't say what the minimum time is that they're required to be posted. So here's what we do. We say, consistent with the case law, that you have to provide the agenda within a reasonable period so the citizens can know whether to attend the meeting. Usually that's at least 48 hours. That's a rule of thumb. By the way, frequently, issues come up at meetings that are not expected by the official who prepared the agenda. Can those be considered at the meeting? Here's the answer to that. If they were A, unexpected, B, there is a reason they need to address it at this meeting rather than putting it off to the next meeting they can agendize, then they can address it. So one, unexpected, two, it's necessary to address. If they need the two-part test, then they can address it even though it's not on the agenda. Otherwise, expect it to be something they put off to the next meeting when they can properly agendize that issue. Minutes. There are actually three different kinds of minutes now called for by Georgia law. First, a summary, which is in 48 hours, 48 business hours, just says generally what happened at the meeting. Secondly, there's regular minutes, which are not open until they're approved, but they must be approved by the next meeting. Then they're open. And those minutes say who attended, what the notice or what the motions were, who seconded those motions, and if there wasn't a unanimous vote, who voted for that particular motion. There's also a requirement now that there be executive session minutes, which are not open. Those only exist for courts to look at if they went into executive session. Executive session, a fancy phrase that means we met in private, we were not open, the public could not observe what we did. Okay, now let's talk open meetings exceptions. And again, I'm going super fast through this in the interest of time, but if you have questions, you stop. Okay, the first one is one I want to give a little emphasis on, particularly for the few government officials I have in here, so it's understood. This is so often misunderstood. Attorney-client privilege only exists under the Open Meetings Act to consult with your attorney in private about litigation. So there's a couple things there. First of all, you're consulting with your attorney. It does not exist to go in and have the members, say, of a city council talk with each other about litigation. They can do that while they're talking with their attorney, but it exists to consult with the attorney only. That's what it exists for. Secondly, it has to be litigation. It can't be something that we think might someday somehow result in litigation. All attorneys exist because maybe something can go into litigation or it's in litigation. The courts have resolved this by saying there has to be what it's, the courts have called a tangible threat of litigation. And that normally means a piece of paper that says, I am going to sue you. Not a piece of paper that says, I don't like you. Not a piece of paper that says, you owe me some money. Not a piece of paper that says, I think you did bad. It says, I am going to sue you. There's a case where there was some probable cause indictments issued by a grand jury against some city council members. They went into executive session to discuss this. This is a probable cause indictment. They're going to probably be in court. The Supreme Court said, that is not a tangible threat of litigation. But it didn't say, I am going to sue you. We had a case with the city of Savannah. We've amicably resolved it. It's good. The city of Savannah had a council member who had some water damage. I think the initial amount of water damage that was shown was somewhere in the $5,000 to $10,000 range. By an audit. They went in, had a private meeting. To be sure, they had an attorney present for that private meeting. They had a piece of paper from the council member that said, here are my damages. Would you pay me? It did not say, I am going to sue you about these damages. They did not go into private to talk to their attorney about how much they should pay or how they would defend this case should they get sued. They went to talk about how much they were going to pay her. That is not attorney-client privilege. That's not an attorney-client communication. So, no threat of litigation that was tangible, no communications actually with the attorney about attorney advice, didn't fly in our view. Ultimately, we entered into an agreement with them that it was a violation. And by the way, they paid her almost $60,000. Okay, moving through these exceptions. Tax matters should be self-explanatory. Real property transactions, they can meet in private to talk about acquiring, selling, leasing, combined transactions of real property, even have a sort of straw vote, pre-vote, as long as they vote in public, formalizing it, they can talk with real property transactions. Staff meetings should be self-explanatory. The law enforcement stuff, obvious. Mediations, that's in only litigation where you've got actual litigation. Email, and we include an email text messaging. This is a new exception that was created by the General Assembly. While the emails and text messages are open records, so you can look at them, you're allowed to email and text your fellow members on your board, council, commission, and so forth without having a meeting. So, go back to the travel question. Yes, you can drive in your car together. No, you cannot discuss business in the car while you're driving. But you can text each other. And that's okay. Sir, we've got a question right over here.
So does that mean a group of councilmen and women could have a phone call? Does that mean a group of councilmen and women could have a group phone call or a group phone call?
No, it doesn't. This says email, text messaging, and that's what it's limited to. So if you have a phone call, that is a meeting if you have a quorum on the call. By the way, local governments who do not have statewide jurisdiction are not allowed to have phone meetings except in very rare circumstances. Usually only it's like one or two members can't make it to the regular meeting, and so they'll phone them in and put them on a conference call. But no, phone message, if you have all the folks talking on the phone, that's a meeting. They're talking about business. Okay, the personnel exception, I'm just gonna briefly mention that. For personnel, the personnel exception is very complex. The bottom line is you really only can meet in private to discuss specific personnel or to interview for the head of the agency. And let's go through that. I said discuss. I did not say to meet with that personnel. I meant to discuss amongst the board members. Those personnel. No receiving evidence, no voting in private, no scolding people in private, even though that might be good and it's certainly been embarrassing, and we're not seeking to embarrass anybody. The law calls for these to be in the open except for discussions about it. And it has to be specific, not policy. And the new exception, if you're interviewing and it's the head of the agency, you can do it in private. Frankly, short of interviewing the head of the agency, I do not know why boards or commissions as a whole interview at all. That really isn't what they should be doing. They have people they employ to do that. The head of the agency, for instance. Okay, executive session, I've mentioned that before. The same thing applies, sir. Hold on one second.
If the council is interviewing applicants for a board, zoning board of appeals, planning and zoning board, are those held in executive session?
They should not be. Those aren't head of the agency type positions. And by the way, discussions about existence on the board or not itself, let me come back to this. Meetings of by an agency discuss taking action or filling a vacancy in the membership of the agency itself, always open. Always open. And certainly if you're talking about board input, if they have a meeting to do that, that meeting should be open. They don't have to have a meeting to do that, by the way. A lot of times those things are delegated. But if they are, should be open. Okay, executive session requirements. Chair has an obligation to keep them on track in executive session. It's very easy to get off that. This is the closed meeting. You have an affidavit. After the meeting, it talks about, if you check the box, but it says, this is why we met for one of these limited purposes I've just outlined for you. Okay, open records. Bottom line, always interpreted in favor of openness, not closed records. There's a question way in the back part of here.
When you discussed notice for regular meetings, I was waiting for you to discuss notice for temporary committees. A committee that's assigned to conduct the business of an organization and they're just temporarily going to be working. What are the parameters for notice for those types of committees?
Okay, if you're talking about a committee that's formally appointed, our office will not touch it if it's not a committee that's been formally appointed. Formally appointed committee has exactly the same requirements as the agency itself. Meaning that that committee has to give sufficient notice, and that's going to be, usually it's going to have to be 48 hours if it's a special meeting, but a week plus if it's a regularly called meeting of that committee. Okay, they have to post it on their agenda, and they have to post a notice on their meeting site, and they're going to have to keep minutes, as I mentioned. Exactly the same requirements if it's a formally appointed committee. Okay, documents. What is a document? It's not as hard as it looks. By the way, the old definition of document was unbelievably confusing. So here's the deal. Everything of every kind that is a recording is a document, period. Typed up stuff, printed up stuff, drafts of that stuff, stuff with interlineations or notes on the side, that's another document. Post-it notes that are stuck on that, post-it notes that are by themselves. Calendars, notes on the napkin from the restaurant. Text messages, email messages, data that is kept on a computer. All of that stuff is a document. Citizens are entitled to look at all of that, unless it falls within privilege exception, like social security numbers and so forth, which we'll talk about in a minute. Citizens are entitled to see all of it. Let's go through what that means in some detail. Let me cover the request.
I have a question, Mike.
Yes.
Just in the definition of a document, what about video or audio recordings?
Absolutely. Video, audio, done by city, for instance, I mentioned a suit against the city for the recording. Not only did this woman take a video of the meeting, the city had its own video of the meeting. That's open. She got it, the proper document. Photographs that are taken, those are open. Now remember, as I said at the beginning, we're talking about documents that are in existence in the government employee's hands at the time the request is made. So, let's say they've got a draft, and they're going to go to a final, but they're not at the final yet, and you've asked for it, it's just a draft. If you want the draft, you're entitled to the draft. That's the document that exists at the time. It is not their right to say, I'm not going to give it to you because we're going to make it a final document. They can say, would you wait while I finalize it? And if you say no, then you're entitled to it. They can say, can I mark a draft? And if you say yes, they can mark a draft. They certainly should put a note on it that says this is a draft. They shouldn't alter the document. All of the documents that are in existence at the time the requests are made are the ones you're entitled to. You're not entitled to say, create a document for me. That's not in existence. Only the documents that are in existence are the ones you're entitled to. There's a question right here. And then you've got one in the back as well.
Get there first.
So what about the contents of the database?
We're going to get to that. Be patient. I'm going to cover that. Probably in not enough detail, but I will definitely cover database contents. Yes?
Yes. Can someone simply just make an appointment to get a government entity to come in to inspect the documents and without being charged a fee just to inspect it?
We'll get to cost, but the answer is if they have to collect those documents for you, then you can be charged for the time to collect those documents. If they have to redact some information from those documents, for instance, let's say they have Social Security numbers on there, they're probably going to need to make a copy before you review them and mark out Social Security numbers. You can be charged for that. So if they're just documents that they keep in a drawer that don't have any confidentiality in there, and they don't, and you say, I want to see that drawer right there, yeah, you're entitled to do that. And there will be no charge. We'll talk about costs in a minute. There's a question way in the back.
It involves the school system bringing in court reporters into IEP meetings. And then when, which involves FERPA, possibly, but once they bring the court reporter in, those records are public records? Or do we make open records requests? Because, you know, has HIPAA information possibly about a child's disability and other concerns? How do we deal with that when a court reporter refuses to give you educational records?
In fact, I do education law as well, I deal with FERPA frequently, which is a federal law that protects students' records. So student information that's in records is not open to the public. One of the exceptions we'll discuss. However, first of all, if you're the parent or guardian of that student, FERPA does not prevent them from giving you the records. In fact, it requires them to give you the records. That's the first part of FERPA, says you must give it to the parents or guardians of the student. That's part one. Part two, you asked about a transcript. You have an IEP, which is a special meeting for students who are getting some special needs treatment in the school. If they transcribe that IEP, you're entitled to that record if you are a parent or guardian of that student. If you're not, it's FERPA, you're right, you can't get it. But if you are, you're entitled to it. There's a question right here.
Where do the documents have to exist? Do they have to exist on the government agency's database or server, or does the request extend to personal computers or personal items, cell phone, whatever else you might?
Well, let's cover that. So that's a fair question. In our office's view, we'd like you to think about it like this. If it is a government-owned piece of equipment, everything that's on that is open. Got a laptop, say, that an official is using. And that laptop is paid for by their government they work for. Everything that's on that laptop, except for computer programs, is open. Everything. Now, there may be exceptions. There may be some stuff that would be in litigation if they're an attorney, or, you know, maybe you've got Social Security numbers, stuff like that, that can be taken out. But if it's on a government-provided piece of equipment, open. Little Johnny's dental appointment that's in an email is open if they wrote it on the laptop. It's okay. Still, it's just open. Does not make it bad, just open. What if you write it on a privately owned piece of equipment? In our view, that is open if it relates to governmental business. So, officials are not allowed to take their, say, smartphones and start texting their other officials about business and say it's closed because I used my own smartphone. You conducted business, that was public business, it's open. You need to provide it, which generally means you need to provide a copy of that. We don't expect the phone to be produced. We expect the message to be transmitted. Way in the back.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry. Just a moment, sir. Just a moment. Got one closer.
Do you need to know exactly what documents you're requesting, or can you ask for a list of relevant documents from a meeting?
Well, when you ask for documents, your document request should specifically say what documents do you see. You really don't have the right to say, could you give me a list of certain documents that relate to this, because that's asking for the government to create a record for you. They don't have to create a record for you, they only have to produce the documents that exist. A lot of times, though, you have a very complex set of requests. As a citizen, very helpful to work with your government officials. I recognize a lot of people have distrust. Still need to work with your government officials. You're going to save yourself some time and energy if you work with them. You can ask for documents that will help you work for them. You think it's on the computer. Could you give me a copy of the databases that you keep in this area? They will probably have a list of those databases. Okay. But they don't have to create a document for you. Same thing's true for government officials. The few government officials that are in here, very helpful for you to work with the citizens. You get a request that's way overbroad, happens every day. The way to respond is not to write a letter that is too hard to decipher and really doesn't help anybody. It's better to pick up the phone if you have their phone number and say, hey, you asked for this, but that A, isn't something we really keep, and B, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg if we really have to produce this. Aren't you really seeking this? And they say, oh yeah, that's all I really want. Okay, then put that in writing and send them what they really want, and everybody can be happy. Doesn't have to be hard. Does require working together a bit. It really does. Okay, question, way in the back.
Yes, sir. I was just trying to find out, do personal written records, let's say you're taking notes in a meeting, you're a meeting of the council, are those part of the documents that could be requested?
If you're a government official, say you're on the city council, and you're making notes during that meeting like crazy, and a citizen says, I want the notes by such and such, you're entitled to them.
Thank you.
Okay. There's a question up front. I'm trying to. That's all right.
So what if you've been given, you've put forth an open records request.
Yes.
You've received documents, but it is not all, and you know what you're looking for, and you know what it should entail and what should be there, and it's not all there. What's the recourse of getting it all when you go back to that board or agency and say, that's not everything? They keep pushing back. You know what you're looking for, and it's not there. What's our recourse at that point?
Okay, well, let's go through this. First of all, and the question, of course, is, they produced some documents to you, and you know there's got to be some documents out that they haven't produced. First thing you need to do is go back and look at your request. I would make a new request to them to start with about the specific documents that are missing. So there's no question that you're seeking those documents. Now, they have a couple options. One is to say, we already produced those. If you say, no, you didn't, I think you're entitled to at least one bite of the apple where they produce them to you again. That doesn't happen, okay? They may say those documents do not exist. Those documents do not exist. Don't come to my office and say, they just said the documents do not exist, because I can't do anything about that. If they do not exist, they do not exist, whether they're supposed to have them or not. Which means that, as far as open records goes, you're at a dead end. But there is a state law that requires records to be retained. Different records, depending on what the substance of those records has in them, affects what's supposed to be retained. So they may be, we're supposed to keep that record. And there may be avenues for dealing with that through the Secretary of State's office, through other stuff. Our office can't do anything about that. If they didn't retain it, they don't got it, we're at an end with our office because we can't fix that. And by the way, if you say you got it and they say no, we don't, we can't say, okay, well, you're supposed to give it to them anyway. We got nothing at that point. That's the end of the day. Okay? And at the end of it, if you think you can prove that they had it and they're refusing it to produce it to you, then what you have to do is get a lawyer and take them to court. And if they didn't produce those records that were in their possession intentionally, and you can prove that, you're entitled to fees. You're entitled to perhaps more to sanctions, okay? Or other things. I can't necessarily say you're going to get damages out of that, but there are remedies, but that's the bottom line. You think you can prove that, you need to take them to court at the end of the day. And by the way, some governments, they're rare, but some government officials think, I got an open records request, the first thing I need to do is start shredding documents. This is not the right response. The documents that are in existence are open. It is a felony to destroy government documents. It's a misdemeanor to violate the Open Records Act. It's a felony to destroy documents. Serious deal. Okay?
That was my next question. If you've been notified that they have been destroyed.
Yeah. And you tell us, we can't, that is a criminal matter that has to go through the district attorney. Okay. But it is a criminal matter. Thank you. Absolutely. If it's a state official, then we can deal with it. But a whole other matter. But let me briefly mention now, just briefly, governments are now allowed to have open records officers. If they have one, send your request to them. Don't just send it to anybody. You can make an oral request. Always make it in writing. It's a lot clearer if you do that. And you can't enforce an oral request. They've got an Open Records Act officer. You need to have a written request. So make your request in writing. Be friendly. Be reasonable. You know, tell them exactly what you want. But you don't have to be unkind about it, but make it in writing. Okay. Immediate access. The law calls, you're going to get access to the records within 3 business days. Not just a response, access. However, you're going to see the exception sort of eat that immediate access up. Okay, 3-day letters. There are 3 situations where a government can write you a letter, in fact, sometimes must write you a letter, rather than respond. Yes?
Chambers of Commerce exempt from this?
It depends on whether the Chambers of Commerce is an agency or not. The rules on that are complex, but here's the bottom line. The Chamber of Commerce gets a third of its funding from state or local sources. It's an agency. If the Chamber of Commerce has had some sort of governmental function transferred to it, we think that specific part of those records will be open. If the Chamber of Commerce has received documents to hold for a government, it's open. And by the way, don't buy if someone says to you from a government side, hey, we took our records and we gave them to this company to hold the records for us, so we can't produce them to you. Well, it's true. The Open Records Act only applies to the records held by the agency. But that third party that took those records and is holding them has now made itself subject to the act. Your right to those records is not cut off by giving them to somebody else. Okay? They do that, they're going to open the door up for them. And if they have a fee structure with them, then that's their problem, as long as they only charge you the fees that you're required by statute. Okay, so here's what the 3-day the requirements for the letter.
Charge you a flat fee, period. You come into a governmental entity, you want to do an open records request, they hand you a form that says, we're always charging you $25, period. And you may not even get anything back for that. We're charging you $25, you got to give up the $25 when you turn in that request.
That's if it's an executive branch agency and they don't have a statute that says they can charge you a flat fee for it, which sometimes they do, then they're going to apply the cost provisions that we'll discuss in just a moment. Okay, in other words, they don't have a statute that says you can charge a flat fee and they're going to charge you only these costs. And if they charge you a different fee, then they are doing it wrong. Okay, we'll talk about, you and I can talk about exactly what the, who that is. Okay, so just so you know, they can write you a letter, sometimes have to write you a letter. One of these three situations exists. Number one, the documents are not readily available, meaning they're going to have to go gather them. Then they have to tell you when they're going to be available. Number two, you're going to have costs charged to you. Here's the bottom line on costs. If it's $25 or less, they can gather the documents and send them to you without a letter. You don't need to say, I'm willing to pay $25. You owe up to $25, depending on what the costs were, if it's $25 or less. If it's more than $25, up to $500, they must give you an estimate of the costs in advance.
In writing?
In writing. That's a three-day letter. Estimate of how much production will cost. They must give that to you in advance. We want agencies to contact you back and say, is that okay? And you can agree to it or say, no, that's wrong, let me change my request. Or correct it somehow so you don't have to pay all this amount that they want to charge you. What if it's more than $500? In that situation, they can say to you, not only here's our three-day letter, here's our estimate, but we're not going to do anything on gathering these until you pay us.
I have a question back here.
Yes.
Can one government official from a different department make a request and still be obligated to pay these fees? In other words, or even from a separate municipality or separate county or something like that, is there any courtesy, or are they just as obligated to pay for these fees?
Look, if one, there's no simple answer to that. I can put it this way. If I'm investigating somebody in my role, I can make an open records request on them and I don't have to pay a fee to get the records. But if you represent such and such a municipality and want records from this municipality or city and county, and I see this all the time when they ask for each other's records, yeah, they can charge each other for those. Unless they've got some sort of agreement that they worked out, we're not going to do that. But yes, they can charge for those. Ma'am.
Educational records. School system says we have the records, this is going to cost for us to reproduce the records, yada yada. I'm a citizen, I'm a taxpayer of Georgia. My copy machine over there?
We think you can, yes.
And plug it up?
As long as you are not interfering with their business, you can either just come and look at the records and not pay the 10 cents per page and the time to copy those, or you can bring in your own machine. Scan them, whatever you want to do. As long as you don't interfere. In fact, there's a statutory provision now that relates to that. Okay? But the key here is that you not interfere with their day-to-day operations or business.
So when you say that I want to come in make appointment to review the records, then you won't be interfering, is that correct? Because they're allowing that appointment time.
Well, right, as long as you're not wheeling, you know, the IBM super duper thing in the block of hallway, I think you're probably okay. Okay, do we have another question?
Would that include digital photography?
I think digital photography is fine. If you want to come in with your camera and take pictures of what they got, you're entitled to do that. As long as it's not something they have an exception they can assert, no social security numbers and so forth, okay? We're going to try to find time to talk about that in a minute. Okay, cost, very quickly. 10 cents per page. That's the actual photocopy cost. In addition, you can be charged for the search, redaction, retrieval, and so forth time at the lowest prorated hourly rate of an employee who can do that in their, that is, the government agency's view of who is that employee who can do it. We try to avoid fee disputes. We often can't resolve those, sir.
What about charging the rate for the entire department? If there's two people in the department and it's $125 an hour between the two individuals in the IT department, what about charging the departmental rate? Is that valid or not?
I don't know what that means. Let me answer it like this. If they've got two people who they think are the people who have to answer this, because no one else can do it, you're entitled to charge the rate, our prorated hourly, for those officials. I don't care if there's someone else who's cheaper in there. If they think those two people are necessary, that's probably okay. If they pick someone who's outrageous and is not necessary, then we'd have a problem. They have to do this reasonably and by the law. But it's very hard to inspect that, I would agree. But no, they can't just say, you're not just entitled to say, I want the lowest paid person to do this. The law doesn't provide for that. There's another question right here.
What if you make a request and they don't give you an estimate, and then they subsequently call you up and say your material is ready to pick up, it's $150?
Our view is this. Okay, they don't have to give you an estimate less than $25, but if it's between $25 to $500, you are required to get an estimate. If they don't do that, they say, hey, we owe us $125, I think they're probably out of luck. Now, there's been some disputes about that, but I think that at the end of the day, they didn't give you the estimate, and you can show they didn't give you the estimate, then you're right. Okay? Proving that can be hard sometimes. That's the bottom line. They're not allowed to tack on an estimate at the end and say, oh, by the way, write us a check. I want you to know, though, there is a provision in the law for the citizens that says that if the fees have been lawfully assessed, in your situation, they were not, and those are the correct fees, and you refuse to pay, then for any future request until that payment is resolved, they can require a prepayment. Okay? There's a question right here.
Through my many years of working for Georgia Legal Services Program, I would ask for expensive records that were very costly. And I think it was there something under the old law, I'm not sure, under the new law, of whether or not a agency can waive or...
Absolutely. They don't have to charge you the fees if they don't want to.
Right.
That's not illegal to say, I'm not going to charge you. They can choose not to charge. In fact, our office routinely does not charge. We, you know, will say, you know, unless it's going to be hundreds and hundreds of dollars, we're going to probably say just have the records as a courtesy. But no, they don't have to charge, and you can ask them to waive the fee.
Well, usually for a nonprofit organization or for someone who doesn't have many funds, I mean, that right. You know, is indigent to ask for those types of exemption. You know, please waive the fee.
Absolutely.
Right.
That's a legitimate thing to do. They have, and I can't promise you they'll waive it, but right. You have the right to ask.
Right.
Absolutely.
I have another question, Rebecca.
Do you need to be a Georgia taxpayer or even U.S. citizen to request an open?
The law now, since April 17th last year, allows anybody to ask. It used to be you had to be a citizen of the state. No longer the law. Anybody can ask. Okay.
We have no more questions.
Citizens, well, I have one question. Do they have to give you, provide a written receipt that they have given you an estimate?
You have to get the estimate. If they're required to give you the estimate, that's more than $25, they have to do that in writing.
Okay, so that would be your proof that if you didn't get that, then that shows they didn't give it to you?
They didn't give you a writing, okay, then they may have waived the right to collect any fee at all.
Okay. And is there a documentation of what they've done with the fees once they've collected them?
You mean if you pay them the fee, what do they do with that money?
Yeah, basically. I was trying to be more subtle than that.
Yeah, no, that's not a problem. There's nothing in the Open Records Act that answers that question. Normally, that money may be expected to go into their general revenue fund, but, you know, I can't answer that.
Maybe that should be in the next law.
Well, that is a different set of laws. It's actually a different title that relates to those costs. And there is very specific laws on that. But it does not involve open records. Once you give them the money, if they don't correctly use that money, then they may be committed a crime. They misappropriated the funds. But that, nonetheless, not an open records question. There's a question right back there.
In reference to the fees associated with the open records, what did you think that the officials associated with providing those open records tend to actually move the goalposts in terms of what you should be paid? How do we know what a reasonable fee is?
You're going to have to judge for yourself what that is. But I'm going to tell you that if it's more than $25, they can tell you what the fee is. If you believe that it's excessive, you need to contact them and negotiate that with them in terms of what's really being called for and why it costs that. If they've given you a fee that's intended simply to scare you away, and you've got your options,
come to us. We can rarely deal with the issues, but you can try coming to us, or you can take it to court. But hard to deal with. There is a point where we have to say, you know, this is within the realm of reason. That's what you owe. And the way to address it is write a new request. It's different, more narrow. It addresses where the fees are so you don't have to pay them. Another question. Ma'am.
If you're seeking open record documents, and specifically you know that in a particular agency, let's say even the Board of Education, is you're requesting documents, but you're not calling it exactly what they have it named, is there some type of directory or catalog that each agency is required to keep so that a public individual who has tried to work with and be in conjunction with this agency, but because you do not see eye to eye, this may not be the easiest thing that you can do. Is there some type of catalog or directory we as a citizen can request?
In general rule, there are no catalogs or directories that are formal that say, these are all the documents that we have. And people create hundreds and hundreds of documents every day. And there's no list of what those documents are. If you want, you can sometimes ask for, hey, give me a list of the documents that you got printed out from, say, Microsoft Word. Maybe they've got that availability to do that, and they can print you that list. You know, it's not easy necessarily to get that list. Give them the best description that you can. Let me try, ma'am. It's a 70-minute presentation.
So if you don't want to pay for copying fees, can you ask for documents electronic, and are they required to provide them?
If they have them in electronic format, I've already covered that really. If they have them in electronic format, you are entitled to get them in that electronic format. So let me briefly answer this question, and then we're going to take a break. Okay? To briefly answer that question. Actually, I don't know if the answer is that brief, but I'm going to try to answer it sort of lightning speed. Okay? Here's the deal, folks. I want you to think about it like this. This is a simple way to understand electronic data, including email. Okay? First of all, we're talking about documents in existence. Matter of fact, when we take a break, after we get back, well, I've got a few minutes, I'll talk to you in more specificity about email itself, because that's always so difficult, and how to make a request. But let me tell you about data first, just data. On a computer system, whether they know it or not, there are files in that computer system called data files. You are entitled to see those data files. You are not entitled to see the programs. The way the computers work is they take the data out of the data file and they compile it, either into an electronic output that you can look at on a computer, or something like a computer, or they print it in a hard copy. You're entitled to see it either way. Either way. You can see the data, and if it's been compiled, you can see the compilations of those documents. That is, when I say compilation, I don't mean they went out and did work for you. I mean they just ran the program from the data they had, and here's the output. Okay? If it's an electronic output or if it's email, we'll talk about email after we take a break, we send it to you. Okay, that's fine. You forward that email. So let's talk about, say, an Excel spreadsheet as an example. Let's say you know, you don't have a list of documents, but you happen to know the name of an Excel spreadsheet. And you ask for that Excel spreadsheet, and they have it. And let's say there's no privileged information on that Excel spreadsheet. The correct response is to forward you the Excel spreadsheet. This should take no time. It should be essentially free. In fact, the first 15 minutes that they're looking for it is free. So just, here it is, email, gone, done. That's the document production. It's free. There's no letter. There's nothing. What if there's confidential information in that Excel spreadsheet?
Well, Excel has columns and rows that go across. Let's say that row AA is social security numbers. We all know that's privileged and private. The way to respond to that, if you're on the agency side, is you search and replace social security numbers with a word like redacted. That means you struck it out. You took it out, or you put asterisks in there. Something that shows it came out. This takes seconds to search and replace. You replace that, then you forward it. You got it. Probably free, if it's very easy. What if you don't know the name of the Excel spreadsheet? You say, I want an Excel, your data on such and such. If they have that data readily available on the spreadsheet, they find it, they send it to you. There might be a little administrative time to do that, but it shouldn't be difficult. What if you ask for stuff that's in three different data columns and three different spreadsheets? Correct way to respond to that is to send all three spreadsheets. It is not to make a new spreadsheet that has the new data in it. Send the existing spreadsheets. You do not have to write documents as a responder. You only have to produce the documents in existence. So you send the spreadsheets that already exist with the redaction if necessary. You're done. What if they never created a spreadsheet to start with, but the data is on their computer system? Then they must send you the data in a data file, and it's up to you to be able to read it. Well, let's go back. What if it's, in fact, an Excel spreadsheet, and you say, I don't own Excel. I don't like Microsoft. I refuse to use Excel. And they say, well, we have an Excel spreadsheet. And you say, I don't want an Excel spreadsheet. I want it in Lotus 1-2-3 from 1998. No. They can give it to you in Excel. If you do not own the program that you need to read it, that is the responder or the requester's problem, not the agency's problem. A lot of agencies for certain kind of data use, in fact, very specific proprietary programs to read that data. As a citizen, you may not be able to make sense out of that data. They have never compiled it in any format. They just got the data to use in this program you don't have access to. You can get the data, but you may not be able to read it. That's the way of the world. It is not the agency's obligation to put it in a new format for you. Unless it's just a standard flat file format, which is called ASCII. Okay? If you can read that and want it that way, that's fine. They can, and they can produce it that way. Then they can produce it in that format. Or you could say, I want a printout if they've got a printout of it. If they don't have a printout, what you're going to get, if it's just data, is you're going to get gibberish. It's computer code that's going to make no sense to you. You get it, but it will be meaningless. I think we're going to take a break.
We are.
Yes? Okay, and then if I've got a few minutes, I'll talk to you about email and a few other exceptions.
All right, yes. So when we come back from break, we're going to take a 10-minute break, and there is some absolutely fantastic food and desserts from over there. We're going to come back and talk about email and web and investigative exceptions. Okay, so I'll signal 10 minutes. In closing, there are, I really like bringing diverse people together, whether it's diverse by race or religion or thought or perspective. It's pretty much what I've been practicing both professionally and in my volunteer work. So I just want to note all the diversity of thought that's sitting in this room. We have a representative from the state PTA of Georgia here. We have a couple of people from the League of Women Voters. We have board members from nonprofit agencies who are probably subject to a lot of these laws sitting in here. We have charter school board members sitting in the room. We have business associates, business associations from a couple of cities sitting in the room. We have people from the Republican Party, people from the Democratic Party, and people from the Tea Party sitting in this room. We have advocacy organizations, we have lobbyists, we have custodians of records, and we have people who file a lot of open records requests. So I just want to give a big round of applause for a room full of very diverse people. And I think I'm really pleased that we're off to a good start with a room full of people and learning from each other and just trying to get to some solutions. So, Mr. Ritter, you're up.
All right.
You have the remaining, you have some time, okay? But I have a couple gifts to give out, so you have to leave me 5 minutes. You can't miss the gifts, right? Right, that's
okay.
All above board. I hope someone's recording this.
Yeah. We can pass those on to someone else. Okay, folks, again, I'm going to try to move through this pretty quickly, but ask your questions. Get them all out in the open before we're done tonight. Let me start by addressing briefly a question about what about data dumps where they change the format or give you the data in a format that they don't normally keep it in, whatever. Let me tell you, data, of course, can be kept in multiple different file formats. They must produce the data to you if it's not a printout or it's not something that is computer generated. They must produce the data to you either in the format that they keep it or in ASCII or as a printout. That's it. Form that they keep the data, so if they keep data in a certain file format, that is the format that they're going to produce that data to you. Well, here's another thing they could do sometimes with that data. At least they try to do, they shouldn't do it. They may strip the data of identifying codes. Data today in these data files often isn't just a series of, here's the numbers you plug in, but it tells you what column or where it goes or how it's used. There's a variety of data that accompanies it. Sometimes it's called metadata. That data is open too. And we do not think that it is legal to strip the metadata out of any kind of document that has that data. I'll give you an example that may be a little bit less obvious to you. We've just gotten done, I think we're done, with a Fulton County Tax Commissioner who did not want to produce records that he had of properties in Fulton County. First he said, we got this data on a website. And I will tell you, let's go back. On the bottom, you see it's legitimate to provide it through the web. That's only true if providing it on the web provides as easy access to the data as us just giving it to you. His web did not work because you had to enter every single parcel one by one to get it rather than getting the data file. That is not equivalent production, so that doesn't count as producing it on the web. That's not equal. Secondly, then they said, okay, we'll produce it, but we're not going to give you the codes or the tags in it to show you how it's used, because we think that's a trade secret. No, it's not. If it's part of your data file, it's open. So all that data that's in there. Now, just so you know, when we're talking about a document that's written, say, in Microsoft Word, or an email that's written in Outlook, or many other programs as well, they have data with them as well, still metadata. Tells you when it was created, who created it, when it was edited, when it was deleted, if it's, you're looking at the registry file. In our view, metadata is also a record and it's also open, shouldn't be stripped. There's private stuff in the metadata. Normally it's not the private stuff that's covered by the Open Records Act, excluding it from production. In other words, metadata, in our view, is open. Okay, let me go to email, as I promised. If you get, on the government side, a request from a lawyer, it's for sure going to be overbroad. Because lawyers can't write requests that are just, please produce exactly what I want. They're going to say, I want any and all documents or every document that relates to some broad, vague subject area and expect you to gather these documents if you're a government employee. As a citizen, don't write those requests. Here's why. Because they're going to cost you a fortune
if the government literally complies with what you requested. You cannot ask for them to produce all of the documents that relate to some broad subject area and expect them to intelligently respond to that. The way to request email, in my view, this is me speaking, my view how to ask for email, you say, I would like all of the email exchanged between so-and-so and so-and-so in this range of dates. That's it. You don't say, I want it related to a certain subject area, because that means they have to go through the email and see if it relates to the subject area. You do not ask for obscure topics. You just ask for email from one person to another person. If you want all of one person's email, then just ask for that person's email. Some of that might be excludable. Write your request in a way that it's not excludable. But write it in a way that's specific. Make it easy for the government officials to produce what you've asked for. This is so unnatural to attorneys. But that's really what you should do for open government purposes. Just write the request in a way that's easy for the official to comply with. Put yourself in the shoes of the official. If I got this request, would I know what to do? Don't say to yourself, ooh, I'm going to burn them with this request. This is totally going to blow their mind. They'll never be able to do that. Don't do that. Say, if I was the official, could I respond to this request? How much would it cost if I was an official to respond to this request? You write it in a way that makes sense so that they can respond. Then you'll get a good response. And then if they give you a crummy response, then you got something to talk about. You know, I hate to tell people you wrote a terrible request, go back and do it again. You know, I certainly don't want to have to tell people, and I have told people, this is the way you need to do. This is what you're asking for. I will tell you if you're a government official, just so that you know, not many people here are, the way to respond to the difficult request is to say, thank you for your request. As I read requests, you are asking for and quote them. To literally comply with your request as drafted, it would take, give them a true estimate of the time. 3,000 hours. You know, it will require multiple people to engage in various parts of the request, and I estimate the costs are going to range per hour from $15 an hour to $75 an hour, whatever it's right with. Plus redaction will be required and so. It's enormous because of, but I think, here's the catcher, but I think you are only seeking documents related to whatever. Be specific from the government side, and you send it to the requester and tell, do you just want documents related to this? If we only provide these documents, I think it's only going to cost $150. Most of the time, they'll say, I think that's really what I want. And that's fine, particularly if the government official is honest and says, hey, I don't want to get into a hassle here. I got better things to do. Let me just give you the documents. Here's what I think you want. Here's what the actual cost will be. Let's get to the bottom line. Don't waste our time. Talk to each other and make sense out of this. And that way, this does not have to involve our office. You get right to point. Folks can get their documents. And I tell government officials all the time, if you have a type of document you know they're seeking, but they haven't asked for it right, either produce the document, or if it's not that easy, tell them what the document is so they can get it right. Give them a guide, help them out. Work together, in other words, not against each other. It saves everybody a lot of time and money. Okay, so you made your email request in the right way. Now, I want to point out something here that people seem to have forgotten, and the General Assembly, the legislature, doesn't fully, I think, understand. Here's what you need to keep in mind. Email, when it's created, is almost always on the hard drive of the person who wrote it. Almost always. Not always, almost always. If they're part of any organization, and if they work for the government, they are, it's going to have a server that it went through. That means a big computer system with its own memory. That should have a record of it usually as well, usually. They back it up, they have a backup tape of that. And they always back it up. If they use an outside server to deliver the email, like Yahoo, Gmail, Hotmail, they'll usually, often not produce it, have a copy of that email. Then you go back down the chain to the recipients. They might have sent it to another ISP with a new copy, new backup tape, new set of servers, new set of hard drives. Okay? Once the email's written, it's out there. The question is getting to it. The right way to ask for it is don't ask for a backup tape, because there are thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars to produce those. I won't go into the details for time. Don't ask for backup tapes. It's a waste of your time. If you ask for them to produce it off of individual hard drives, I hope you're asking for only one hard drive to be looked at. Because you're asking for a whole bunch of hard drives, you're going to have a whole bunch of different people, and it's going to cost you a fortune to get it off those hard drives. If you want to do that, ask for it off the server. And ask for the recipients as well as the person who would have sent it. Because a lot of times, you'll find that the person who sent it deleted it, but the recipient didn't. They sent it to five people. One of them probably has what you want. You only need one copy. Okay? Investigative exception. For our purposes tonight, I can tell you that this is probably the most relied upon exception in terms of law enforcement. But you have to fit into this. You have to be an investigative agency to fit into the investigative exception. Personnel files. Just so that you know, the personnel files of government officials are open records. Stuff that's in those files is open. Their home address, home phone number, social security number, stuff like that, that comes out, but the personnel file is open. How about your own information? You know, so many of these documents that are kept by the government are documents that were actually created by citizens, not by the government. Do they have to produce that? Yes, they do. You can ask for information about other citizens. This is the list. I made this list from the statute, which is hard to read. It's my list of what the statute says you do not have to produce if you're on the government side. That stuff comes out. They can charge you to redact that stuff out of the file. Sometimes that involves making multiple copies because they got to have a copy to scratch it out on and then a copy to produce. Yes?
It says can be redacted. That can or shall be redacted.
Let me put it this way.
It's another part to that. And if you sit on a board as a citizen,
is your contact information then accessible too if you sit on the board of an agency?
If they ask for data that is in someone's governmental capacity, and that personal data would come out. But if it's not clear that it's in a personal capacity, it's going to stay in. Okay? Now, as far as may, I could tell you that shall is maybe a better way to read that than may, or can, should be redacted. Because the government should be protecting individuals' rights. And I will tell you that if you're talking about a record that was created by the government, they may have waived their exceptions if they don't give you that 3-day letter. But I do not think, me speaking, I do not think they can waive your rights or anybody other citizen's rights to keep their own personal information private because they failed to respond in time. You had a question?
Yes, thank you. Redacting should be supported, absolutely. However, I have a question regarding redacting. Redacting is going to be required, you know, with a cost assessed to redacting.
Yes.
Should the citizen making the request for the redacting be told that, let's say, we are redacting home addresses, we're redacting, or just a blanket redacting where there's no accountability to the fact that there was any redacting done?
This is how the law addresses that.
Okay.
The law addresses that by saying, in this 3-day letter I mentioned much earlier,
okay,
that 3-day letter has to tell you, the requester, the specific subsections, not just the code, the specific subsections that are being relied upon to take that information out. So for instance, right here, you'll see at the very bottom, I've written OCGA section 50, 1872, A21.
Okay.
Okay. If they take information out on this, they should be citing A21 back to you in that 3-day letter before you, with your estimate. And that's how you know what's redacted. Okay? By far and away, redaction happens on this and this. Well, not gonna, more than anything else. Okay? But that's how you know, they tell you the code sections that the redaction arises from. Okay. I'm not going to discuss trade secrets. I will just mention this. Public employees have slightly broader rights. I'll answer your question in just a moment. And that broader rights is they get their home address and home phone number and identity of their employee or family members taken out. That's because we get threats against us occasionally. Some people more than others, particularly police, judges, and so forth. So that comes out, but it has to be clear that you made a request for a public official's information. In other words, if it's in the deed, all that information is going to be open, public official or not. Ma'am.
Okay. I have a question. Who monitors public entities to make sure that they are in compliance with the open records request? For example, when they say they have provided everything, how's that verified?
If they say they've provided everything, and I discussed this a little bit earlier, they say they have provided everything, and you can prove they have not provided everything, you've got to take them to court. We cannot say, you said you provided everything, but I don't know about that. Our office has no ability to do that. I can't go through their files and say, I see you didn't provide this. You've got to document it, take them to court. That's the bottom line. There's really no other alternative. That could be expensive, from legal aid, but that's expensive. That's what you got.
Okay. One other question. Why has the Attorney General's office not gone after enforcement in some of the high-profile cases that have been in the media? Example, the airport procurement case.
Oh, we were very involved in the airport procurement case. True, we didn't file a lawsuit, but I can tell you that, for instance, Ken Hodges filed his lawsuit. I discussed his lawsuit in depth before he filed that lawsuit. We're involved with lots of issues. Our open government program is completely voluntary on our part. We devote the resources that we can. And I think you know that. I mean, the fact is that we have hundreds and hundreds of contacts. We cannot go to court on almost any of them. We get $0 from the General Assembly for open government. $0 for open government.
Okay. Yes, Harvey. I know a few minutes ago you discussed computer data. So my specific question here is, I understand that when passwords are created, it's generally for accountability sometimes. So if I'm looking to get information about a government official's login and logout from a specific computer, is that not something I'm supposed to be able to get?
If they have a log of that, and they probably do, you need to ask for it the right way. I don't know what the magic computer is for that log, but that log itself is an open record, okay? The passwords are not, but the log about when it was accessed or not, that's open. And in fact, I do know that normal computers are going to have a registry that's going to show in and out.
Mine does.
Yes, do you have another question?
Yes, I have a secondary question. Regarding emails, I understand that there's some government officials that actually have sent out communications specifically stating that they tell their employees to delete emails. And I happen to understand that nothing is really deleted. If in fact, they give you the runaround, and then there's this thing we call the time lapse, in other words, 6 or 7 months goes by where you've been playing games back and forth, and therefore your statute of limitation has run out. Is there anything you can do to actually mitigate your losses simply because they gave you the runaround for a couple of months?
Okay, well that's a complex question. Let me answer it like this. First of all, keep in mind that 90-day period I spoke about on open meetings applies to open meetings. Doesn't apply to records. Secondly, the Open Records Act applies to the documents that are in existence at that time. If they should have produced those documents to you when they had them, they should not have deleted those documents. Deleting them after they've got a request is a serious matter. Because at that time, they have an obligation plainly to have kept them in response to your request. If it's plain, and I want to make clear, if it's plain, those documents were responsive. In other words, as I mentioned earlier, as a joke, but true, government officials who get a request and start deleting records have committed a felony. Okay, you cannot do that. You must produce the records that are responsive instead of trashing. Even if you had the right to delete them beforehand, once you get the request, if they exist, you can't then start deleting them, saying, well, let's pretend we never had that. That's no good. Proving it's a whole other matter. Can our office do something about that? That's a matter for the district attorney to address. Because that's a felony, but that's where it needs to go. Giving you the runaround and not producing the records, you know, at the end of the day, you could try to go through a mediation program. I know there are people out there who think it's not helpful. We do what we can with the hundreds of requests we get. And bottom line, though, is it's better than nothing, but still, it's on you to go to court. We can't help you.
Please, I'm sorry. Okay. Now, you mentioned the district attorney just now. So if, in fact, I or somebody else I know, hypothetical situation, obviously, wanted to go through that specific situation now, which is to contact the district attorney, how can I get that done, or how can they get that done? What's the process?
Okay, look, you call the district attorney's office, and they say, well, you will come and file a complaint, they say we have no interest in it, whatever. They have the right to not prosecute something. I hear about it every day. I swear to you, every day, about people who say the district attorney is part of the problem, the product of the county machine, whatever. I can't answer that. That's not, the law says you go to the district attorney. The district attorney will not address it. The district attorney will not address it. Okay? I happen to think that most of them act in a great deal of good faith. There are probably a lot of exceptions too, but that's the way it is. And they got a lot on their plate. Let's keep that in mind. They can't get to everything.
So, Terry, this is going to be the last question. As a recourse, you can also address the grand jury. You have the right to send any correspondence for investigation to the foreman of the grand jury, and they can investigate.
That's an excellent point. And we rarely recommend that, but actually that's an excellent point, and I appreciate your answer. Okay, folks, I have taken a lot of time, a lot more than we expected, because we have a lot of questions. All the rest of the stuff, though, I think is stuff. Trade secrets, who cares about that? Conclusion, man, it's been great. So, look, we want folks to work with their government, and we want the governments to work with you. If they're not working with you, try with them before you come to us. Because I got so much on our plate that it's very hard to address every single person who comes in the door. You know, we will cut our losses if we have to. But if they cannot work with you, won't work with you, you've got a good case, something that's meaningful, then at least talk to us. We may say sorry, but at least try. Folks, thank you very much.
Let's give Mr. Ritter a big hand again. I'm just going to ask for your patience for 3 more minutes, okay? We've invested this much. And 30 seconds of that 3 minutes is to give Mr. Ritter a locally grown book, Gwinnett, a little above Atlanta. So we're glad you came a little above Atlanta tonight, written by our very own Elliot Brock. And so please enjoy that in good health, and I can't thank you.
Thank you. Copy of it is copyrighted.
And wait a second, and we're going to close this off with C.C. Wynn coming up before we give a gift to the church. As you can see, the volunteerism and the spirit here has been wonderful, so we want to acknowledge them and give a gift to Father Tran. And C.C., if you want to just come forward. C.C. is the individual who was appointed by the church to defend the situation about the land over here with the waste transfer station.
Thank you, Jen. Good evening, everyone. As a former refugee and now a naturalized citizen of the United States of America, I am most grateful for the freedom and the government system the Founding Father had blessed this country with. You see, the problem with the government is not always about all for the people. This is particularly true in many parts of the world we live in today. But not here. Right? Right? Yeah, okay. Well, my personal experience with what Jen was sharing, I mean, it was shocking to me when Fire Friends said, okay, you it, okay? So you go defend the church, okay? But I mean, it's just not me, it's everyone. All of us, all 5,000 of us. I mean, we were shocked completely, but then we did. But I mean, and I shared this story with my friend, Mr. Spring Smith, and everyone else. This is God's house, you know how to do it. Yeah. Okay, we just, you know, whatever, you know? Whatever we need next, we just prepare, and we defend ourselves. So my personal experience has taught me that the phrase, we the people, and the grand notion of the core of what separates this great nation and people from the rest of the world. Be honest, I used to work for the UN, I travel all over the world. This is the best country in the world, guys, okay? It doesn't matter where you're at, the best country in the world right here is America. Yes, there are times when our government had faltered, even failed. We experience and share this failing right here at the Holy Vietnamese Martyr. But this failing also taught us that the remedy to these issues is often to nurture the check and balance in our own government. Check and balance give way to transparency, or a transparent government. A transparent government is an accountable government. Do you agree? Right. That's right. This is why I think what we have learned tonight from Mr. Ritter, and you know, thanks so much, Jen, for putting all together, Ms. Sabrina Smith, and many others sitting here. And many other that will compliment you for your dedication and commitment to this issue. Once again, thank you for being here.
And final parting, Father Tran, will you come forward? So anybody who knows me knows, especially if you, I have two kids, if you were one of the many teachers that they had, they know that I love children and I love reading. And I think that that's one of the most important gifts we can give to our children. So on behalf of Gwinnett Gets Informed, we want to continue to inform little kids. So we have a series of books of classics, King Arthur, Anne of Green Gables, Black Beauty, The Secret Garden, and 20,000 Leagues for your the Eucharist Youth Movement.
Thank you very much.
And so thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you again.